Ah, the pumpkin spice latte, an autumnal joy to behold. It's that time of year when you can find pumpkin spice anything. Pumpkin spice Cheerios, pumpkin spice butter, pumpkin spice protein powder, pumpkin spice dog treats. It might be hard to believe, but pumpkin spice wasn't always that basic. Travel back a couple hundred years and pumpkin spice was only in pies. Crazy, I know. So how did it turn into the omnipresent spice we can't help but fall for today? Do you see what I did? Did you like that or was that cheesy? This is why we're so obsessed with pumpkin spice in 6 minutes. Ready? Let's go. To truly understand pumpkin spice, we have to start with the history of the pumpkin. 10,000 years ago, in a cave in Mexico, a smaller, more bitter pumpkin took its first baby steps. Today, we're more into, you know, stabbing pumpkins than actually eating them. But back in the day, pumpkin was a popular food. Over thousands of years, people indigenous to the Americas cultivated the plant so it could be cut up, baked, boiled, and eaten. And because the pumpkin was relatively easy to grow in the Americas, pumpkin became a staple of the American colonist diet. Yeah, the pilgrims even used pumpkins to make beer.
We have pumpkin in the morning, pumpkin in the noon. If it were not for pumpkin, we would be undone. Hey, I'm a pilgrim.
Their love of that giant squash was even felt overseas. And in France, chefs began sweetening this potato mash into a pastry to make a tart. They called pumpkin pépillon, which means melon, which the English then translated to pompion, almost pumpkin, almost. The states adapted these early recipes and names to create an early version of the pumpkin pie, which became a celebrated food among abolitionists and anti-slavery activists who could easily grow the pumpkin on their own, i.e. without slave labor. Now, pumpkin pie became a quintessential autumn flavor when Sarah Hale, the 19th century Martha Stewart, helped establish Thanksgiving and the pumpkin pie as an essential Yankee dish. Now, before Hale, Thanksgiving was primarily celebrated in New England, and every state had a different date for the holiday. Hale wrote letters to four presidents calling to nationalize the holiday.
Dear President Lincoln, I really think this Thanksgiving idea has legs, turkey legs, if you get what I mean.
Finally, President Lincoln took up her cause as a way to unite the states after the Civil War. Plus, the pumpkin was already associated with abolition, so it really fit the holiday perfectly. And yes, Thanksgiving has its own problematic history, but it's really always just been an excuse to bring together family and food, specifically pumpkin. But enough about pumpkin, because you might not realize it, but pumpkin spice doesn't actually contain any pumpkin. It's more pumpkin-adjacent flavors, and come fall, it's everywhere. So when and how did the pumpkin spice mix start? Meet Pumpkin Spice's precursor, aka the Spice Daddy, aka mixed spice. In it, cinnamon's a dominant flavor, along with nutmeg, allspice, and a few others. But it's missing ginger. It's close, but Daddy Spice still gotta make sweet love to Ginger Spice. Not that Ginger Spice, that one, yeah. In 1796, Amelia Simmons published the recipe for what we consider the classic American pie flavor in American cookery. The recipe, which made a pudding-like pie filling, called for ingredients like 1 pint of pumpkin in a spice mix of mace, nutmeg, ginger, and allspice. Yeah, Amelia forgot the damn cinnamon, but we're getting closer. Fast forward 130 years to the 1930s. The Washington Post publishes a pumpkin spice cake recipe, finally freeing the pumpkin spice from the confines of the pie. Companies like Thompson & Taylor and McCormick start selling pumpkin spice blends in order to make cooking easier. Because measuring out your own cinnamon, ginger, nutmeg, and sulfiting agents is so hard. You know? And around the turn of the millennium, growing behemoth Starbucks started branding its coffees with holiday flavors. Flavors like peppermint mocha to join the eggnog latte. But they needed something to join the fall lineup. So in 2003, Starbucks introduced the pumpkin spice latte, the PSL. The pumpkin spice mix was saucified, added to espresso, and topped with whipped cream. Coffee drinkers went crazy for it, and it quickly became Starbucks' top-selling seasonal beverage. Today, PSL's Twitter account has amassed almost 100,000 followers. And over the past 10 years, tweets and memes have sprung up referring to basic girls sipping on pumpkin spice lattes. It's become more than a spice. It's an identity.
Okay, so guys, where are we doing brunch? Oh no, I spilled some PSL on my Uggs.
Soon other companies started to catch on. By 2013, sales for pumpkin flavored products had reached nearly $350 million. By 2015, more than $500 million. So why are we so obsessed? Well, that has to do with the seasonal nature of the product. We can't get it year round, so when we can get it, we want it, and we want as much of it as we can handle. It's called reactance theory. Look it up. Today, pumpkin spice things exist completely independent from the pumpkin. Pumpkin spice vodka, pumpkin spice cereal, bagels, pumpkin spice bath salts, pumpkin spice toilet papers, pumpkin spice almonds. Pumpkin spice this, pumpkin spice that. There's a lot of pumpkin spice. You could exist solely on pumpkin spice products. I mean, if you wanted to. And for those of you hating on pumpkin spice, know that you're not just hating on a spice mix. You're hating on cinnamon, nutmeg, ginger, and American history. PSL for life, baby. Oh my God, it's cold. It got so cold. Oh well.